Meditation is rebellion, excerpt from Horizons Beyond the Mind. Meditation brings rebellion in life, and it is the rebellion that brings about transformation in your life. It is rebellion against all traditions, conventions, dogmas, creeds, rebellion against the whole past. When a cell phone comes, for instance, Samsung Galaxy 3, this is the model that has now come out. After that, a next model comes, Samsung Galaxy 4. The Samsung Galaxy 4 that comes out has more advancements, more features. So anything that comes at a later stage is an improvement upon the existing one. We accept this. We are always looking for the latest models of these technological things. When it comes to man, every parent considers himself to be wiser than the children. Children are the latest model of human race. You are 25-30 years old model. Your child is the upgraded latest model. Each child is born with tremendous intelligence. The only difference between you and the child is more intelligent, fresh and new, and you are outdated, but you have experience. But that does not mean a parent is more intelligent than the child. Child is the latest model and more intelligent. Look at his level of intelligence. How quickly he learns the computer, the internet, and all these technological facilities. Each child knows more than his parents. But we, out of our ego, does not accept this and want to impose things on the child. We do not feel happy in front of the child saying that you are more intelligent than me. The only difference between you and me is you are more intelligent, I have more experience of various aspects of life. If the experience and technology are put together, there will be a tremendous effort. This is rebellion. Rebellion against the whole past. Remember, unless you are completely cleansed of the past, you cannot be totally here now. No, you cannot be totally here now at all. Unless you are completely cleansed of your past, when I say past, I mean all your past thinkings, traditions, conventions, dogmas, creeds, and everything. You are not free and you cannot be totally here now in the moment when the change can take place. And unless you are totally here now, you will never know what truth is. Truth is neither in the past nor in future. Truth is always here now. Truth means that which is. You cannot use the word was for truth or will be for truth. You cannot say truth will be tomorrow or truth was yesterday. No, truth is now and here. It is always is. Isness is truth. Isness is the very essence of truth. Our mind goes on moving from past to future. It is like a pendulum that moves between the two extremes. It passes in the space between the past and the present, the two extremes, but it never stops in between. And that's where it goes on moving. It is like a pendulum moving from one extreme to another. It never stays in the middle. And the middle is the truth. From past to future, from future to past, we go on shuttling like a goods train. We never stay in the now, and now is the nature of existence. Existence knows only one tense, the present tense. And this is not the present tense that you know in grammar. It is the very precise moment of nowness. The greatest rebellion in life is to drop all traditions and all conventions and scriptures too. Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, the Quran, the Bible, the Gita, all these are part of traditions and conventions. You will have to drop them all in its totality. You cannot attain to meditation and still want to remain a Hindu or a Christian following the traditions of your religious belief. It needs tremendous courage. It needs a man, not a child. It needs certain integrity, some growth as well. And my whole work here is to help you to become more mature so that you can pass through this rebellion. When we talk about the various concepts, we talk about God. God is not important to me. What is important to me is godliness. Godliness is the quality of your being. If you have that, you forget about God. But we stick to our God, which is a hypothetical concept of all the religions. It is the energy that is at play, at work. When we talk about love, God is love. No, God is lovingness. Lovingness is more profound, more precise, more important. If you are loving, you see how your energy begins to move. Feel at any moment when you had been loving to your husband, to your wife, to your children, to your fellow friend, and what was the state of your awareness? Wasn't there like you have got the wings and you can fly? And you keep on taking the name love, love, nothing happens. Be loving, be godly, be creative in anything that you do. Because it is said in all the religions, God is the creator. So what is the quality of the creator? That to be creative. But you can go on singing your psalms and bhajans and mantras, God is creator. But you have no creativity in you. Let there be creativity and God will be forgotten. Let there be godliness, God can be forgotten. Godliness, creativity, lovingness is more sublime. This is rebellion. You are leaving the traditions that you have been trained into. Emphasize on godliness, lovingness, creativity. These are the inherent qualities of the being. My whole effort here is to help you to become more mature so that you can pass through this rebellion. Once you have passed through this rebellion, Christ is born in you, Buddha is born in you. They are different names for the same experience. The experience is same. Whether you call lovemaking in Chinese, Hebrews, Indian, English, Spanish, the experience remains the same. But we keep on holding on to our props that Christ is my God, Buddha is my God, Ram and Krishna or Muhammad is my God or is the only begotten Son of God. But all this happens through meditation. Hence, disciplehood involves around the idea of meditation. I just tell you a simple and single thing. Be meditative and nothing else. Be meditative in anything that you do. You are walking on the road, you are going to make love, you are going to bathe, you are going to change your clothes, you are going to give a hug to your husband or wife. Be meditative in all those acts. Meditation means you are harmonious within, you are blissful within. Then the very touch will be magical, will be mystical. The very embrace will be mystical. Anything that you do that will have a tremendous beauty and mysticism in it. But it all happens through meditation. Hence, disciplehood revolves around the idea of meditation. I just tell you one simple and single thing. Be meditative and nothing else is needed. For meditation, you need no religion or scripture. You are just needed. You don't need to be theist or atheist. You don't need to be a believer in God or non-believer. Meditation contains the entire philosophy of life deep within its womb. And one day out of meditation, thousands of flowers blossom. And once they blossom, they continue blossoming. It's not that their season of spring has come and gone. Once the season of spring comes out of meditation, it never ends. Out of it, everything that is needed comes by itself and you need not search for it. Mind is identified with the body. You feel I am the body. This is the state of mind. Meditation is a disidentification with the body. One starts feeling I am in the body, but I am not the body. It is a lot of difference. I am in the body, but I am not body. I am not identified with body in any way. The body is just like a house and I am dwelling in it. I have lived in many bodies, many houses. So there is no need to cling to this particular house. One day this house is going to collapse, as all houses always collapse sooner or later. But my being is eternal. It cannot collapse. It is beyond all destruction. It is not made of any collapsible material. In fact, it is not made of material at all. Being is just pure consciousness. And consciousness cannot be destroyed. Energy is consciousness and it cannot be destroyed. It can only be transformed. Form can change from solid to liquid, liquid to gaseous. Look at the ice, water and gas, three states of energy. Consciousness is your inner space with no matter in it. This is why Buddha calls this as no self or anatta, devoid of all matter. As you move into meditation, this feeling starts becoming stronger and stronger every day. That does not mean that you start neglecting the body. On the contrary, you are caring about the body more carefully because it is a beautiful house, a gift of God. You have to keep it clean and beautiful, healthy, young and vital, energetic and alive too. Because you have to live in it for many, many more years. That's why my whole emphasis in my cooking or everything is bringing vitality and making the food that brings more and more energy into your body. Body energy at all levels, level of the body, level of the mind, level of the cells, at every level it brings more vitality and energy. There is no need to make it ugly, poor and starved. Make it a palace, a marble palace. Make it a temple, but remember, I am not it. I am in it, but not it. So when it dies, you are not dying. The body is born, the body dies. You are never born, you never die. And meditation is very simple. Just watching, begin with watching. In the process of meditation, three things have to be watched. The first is the body and its actions. When you are walking, watch it. Sit down. The other day, I carried my straightener in my car to get the paint. While he was sitting in the car, his shoulder was vigorously moving, shaking automatically, and he will not be even aware of it. This is the energy that is violent and it needs to express. The first is the body and its actions. We do things mechanically. Walking, watch it. Sitting, lying down, to watch it. As you watch, you will be able to understand I am the watcher and the body is the watched. It is separate from me. The second step, then there is a deeper watchfulness. Watch your mind and its activities, thoughts, desires, memories and dreams. We live in memories which is of the past. We live in dreams. It is said that, what are your dreams? You must fulfill your dreams. This is living in the future, which is not yet. Watch your mind and its activities. It is subtler than watching the body. Your thoughts, desires, memories, and dreams. If you have succeeded in the first, you are bound to succeed in the second too. And then suddenly you become aware, I am not the mind either. In the first place, you were aware that I am not the body. I am in the body. Now, you are aware of that I am not the mind either. Instead, mind is a mechanism that I use to communicate to you. Through the mind, through the understanding, through its development, the words are formed, the sentences are formed, the gaps are formed, and it creates a musical symphony that comes to you, riding the waves of the energy, riding the sound waves. And the second step leads to the third. And with this, the subtlest watching happens. Watch your feelings, sentiments, emotions, and moods. These are very vague and subtle. Watch your heart. And once you have become able to watch all the three, you transcend them all. And then you become aware of the fourth. You are true being. When you have crossed the three, the fourth happens of its own, the fourth way. The fourth dimension, as Gurdjieff calls it, or Turiya, as Hindus calls it, the fourth dimension, which is none of the three. It is the transcendence of the three, transcendence beyond the three. Once you have become able of watching all the three, you transcend them all. I mean all, the body, the mind, and the last. Before that, you were only so alive, just lukewarm. You do not have any intensity. You do not live intensely. You are not passionately living or totally alive. When meditation deepens and happens and it flourishes, it flowers, it blossoms, you are totally alive. You live in totality. To live in totality is to live here now. To live here now.